Hello, and welcome to the Inside Take, our UU Holton weekly service online edition, coming to you from the Stone Room in the basement of a Unitarian church. The Inside Take is an inquisitive look into the interior life and the creative outer expressions it takes in everyday life as we go about living in this extraordinary world. Since this is the first week of Lent, we are starting a new series called Stories of Lent, which will lead up to Easter Sunday in the middle of April. I know that sounds like a long ways off, and yes, spring will come, but that gives us some time to share stories of reflection and encouragement as we try to make it through the rest of this very long winter. Today's story is about achieving a healthy mental outlook in a Maine winter, and it's titled Solitude of Mind. Thank you for joining us. This is the Inside Take. First thing we're going to do is to light our chalice. We'd like the chalice today, a forward-looking to days with less snow and warmer temperatures. May our attitudes be adjusted in a positive, life-giving manner. May we feel an optimistic, warming sensation in our bodies and our mind. May we move forward in these freezing days of winter. We light this chalice. For a moment of centering silence, let us pause just for a moment. Let us notice what is happening in the here and now. Not last week or 5 minutes ago, but right now. Notice the breath, notice the mind, and listen to the song of a singing bowl. Opening words this morning are by poet Margaret Atwood, a poem titled February. Winter, time to eat fat and watch hockey. In the pewter mornings, the cat, a black fur sausage with yellow Houdini eyes, jumps up on the bed and tries to get onto my head. It's his way of telling whether or not I'm dead. If not, he wants to be scratched. If I am, he'll think of something. He settles on my chest, breathing his cat breath of burped up meat and musty sofas, purring like a washboard. February, month of despair with a skewered heart in the center. I think dire thoughts and lust for French fries with a splash of vinegar. Okay, cat. Enough of your greedy whining and your furry bottom. Off my face, you are the cheery life principle, more or less. So get going on a little optimism around here. Cut back on the decrease, celebrate increase. Make it spring and quick. And this morning I have an opening prayer. With the outbreak of war in Eastern Europe, I went back to my old files and found material from 20 years ago, when the world was also caught in a period of war, conflict, and political instability. Here's today's prayer. These are days when our hearts are chilled by the dark shadows of hatred and fear. The winds blow strong and cold snows bury the anxieties of the masses while the powerful prepare for war and reparation. The gentle ways are still present in the world. They are present in the constant requests for peace, justice, and equality. The gentle ways can still be heard, even in the din of human-made commotion. Let us listen today, and we will hear once again the timeless truth that love is the way. Violence has its limits, and hatred has its end, but love is retained to the benefit of us all. Even in the dead of winter, and in the darkest of days, its radiance will endure and warm the hearts of all humankind. This is our hope, and this is our prayer. Amen. Let us go ahead and light candles of joys and concern as we share our life journey together. The story that is heavy on our hearts today is the war in Ukraine, as it continues into a second week. I know many of us are following the details daily, and conditions may have changed since the time of this recording, on Wednesday, March 1st, which is Ash Wednesday. We pray for those fleeing the country for safety, women and children especially, as numbers are anticipated to keep rising. We pray for a ceasefire, that negotiations can bring the conflict to a quick close. We light a candle for those who have died on both sides of the conflict. We pray for peace on this day. World leaders have issued statements this week, including Pope Francis, President Biden during his State of the Union address this week. And here are words offered by His Holiness the Dalai Lama. Day 5 of the war. I have been deeply saddened by the conflict in Ukraine. Our world has become so interdependent that violent conflict between two countries inevitably impacts the rest of the world. War is outdated. Nonviolence is the only way. We need to develop a sense of the oneness of humanity by considering other human beings as brothers and sisters. This is how we will build a more peaceful world. Problems and disagreements are best resolved through dialogue. Genuine peace comes about through mutual understanding and respect for each other's well-being. We must not lose hope. The 20th century was a century of war and bloodshed. The 21st century must be a century of dialogue. I pray that peace is swiftly restored in Ukraine. We continue to light the crisis candle for the continuing coronavirus pandemic. While numbers continue to improve, we continue to be vigilant and cautious until this is all over. And we light a silent candle today for those unspoken prayers, concerns that are unarticulated. And we're going to just take a few minutes for you to reflect at home on who you want to bring into our circle of compassion today. You'll also find more names on our UU support page this week. And we're going to ring a few bells to accompany our prayers, blessing them with positive energy and healing intention. The joy or the sorrow of one is shared by all. May our hearts be as one on this day. Let us carry each thought or concern expressed in our heart, and may the light of our love and compassion transform suffering into non-suffering and ease the difficulties of life. We radiate love and the light that we are. Blessed are we all on this day. Amen, and blessed be. For our music selection this morning, we have Playing for Change, a group of musicians that collaborate from around the world in their different locations, and then it's produced elsewhere into one song. This is how we do music now in the age of Zoom. This song features blues singer Keb Moe, who Linda and I had the pleasure of seeing perform in Waterville, Maine just several weeks ago. And this song ties into our winter blues Lenten theme this morning. And if you look carefully, you'll notice a couple of New Orleans locations, a nod to the recent Mardi Gras celebrations of this past week. This song is called Walking Blues.
Baby, I got these old walking blues. I woke up this morning feeling round for my shoes. Ready? Well, you know about that thing. Look at here, I got these old walking blues.
Leaving this morning, I had to go ride the blinds. I've been mistreated. And I told my dad, leaving this morning, I had to go ride the plane. Yeah. I've been misrated, and Lord, I told my dad.
Some folks tell me, oh, blues ain't bad. I got the worst old feeling that I ever had. Some folks tell me, oh, blues ain't bad. You know I got the worst old feeling, Lord have mercy, I ever had.
Woke up this morning, feel around my shoe. You know about that, babe.
Lent is a traditional time for reflection, contemplation, and restraint from our usual activities. Distractions, you could say. It's a time to recalibrate what we find important in our life and how we spend our time. During the next 5 weeks, we are looking at Lenten stories as a way to explore our relationship to self, others, and the demanding challenges of what's going on in the world right now. Lent is especially well-suited to living in New England this time of year because the seasons become more than just a metaphor. We can feel them when we walk out the front door and watch the numbers change on the thermometer as we inch closer to Easter and spring. Our first story is by writer Ron Curry, a young man who lives in Portland, Maine, who has written 4 novels, including Everything Matters, The One-Eyed Man, and Flimsy Little Plastic Miracles. He's also a regular contributor to Downey's magazine. Winter is not something I enjoy as much as endure. Even when I was a kid, the deep winter days, frigid and brief, filled me with ennui, unmooring me at multiple levels. I think we can all agree that last winter, the 2021 pandemic, was an unadulterated medical waste fire. I won't bother enumerating the end times stressors that bombarded us every day, mostly because we're still dealing with 2/3 of them and no one needs the reminder. But as my doctor noted, in an effort to, I think, make me feel better, he said, even people who aren't crazy were going crazy last winter. As someone with loose circuits from way back, I didn't stand a chance. So I guess I shouldn't have been surprised when the mother of all depressions snuck up behind me in mid-November and threw a burlap sack over my head. Suddenly, I couldn't sleep, couldn't eat, couldn't write, couldn't sit still, couldn't think of anything but escaping from the solitary confinement cell of my own mind. So we rented a little place in Carrabassett Valley during COVID and fled there on weekends from our place in Portland. People go to remote places like Carrabassett Valley to get away for recreation, but they also go for the semi-intangibles, slowing life down, the stars at night, all that frigid beauty, the sound of towering white pines clacking together in the wind after dark. People go, in other words, for the chance to be alone with their thoughts, which was the absolute last thing I wanted. Every morning, I drank my tea, took the pills that were supposed to make my head right again, and sat and watched the sun come up over the river outside our back door, waiting to feel something, anything other than crazy. And though I had about as much motivation as a tree sloth, every day I got out there in the cold of nature and hiked endless miles up and down the foothills with my dog, whose example of relentless good energy and curiosity about the smallest of things felt like a judgment. And then, just as February was about to turn the corner into March, on a day when whiteout squalls blasted through the valley one after another, something changed. Not much, mind you, and not for long. This was hardly an everything's going to be okay moment. Real life leaves those to the movies. But it was proof that I could feel something rather than nothing. This was the first moment in months that I had actually occupied, been present for, not shambled through while troubling over the past or worrying about a decidedly worrisome future. I was just there, alone with my steadfast companion in a blinding squall in Maine's mountain country. And I might have been the only person left on Earth. I was feeling something too, but at first I couldn't identify what. Something tiny yet real, by God. something akin to a candle flame in winter's cold wind. And then I realized I was somehow at ease. My hands unclenched for once. My breath coming deep and steady, cold air in, warm vapor out. So I could probably do a pretty good job of convincing you the isolation and stark beauty of Karabasic Valley conspired bit by bit, morning by crystalline morning, to raise me out of a pit I'd fallen into. I could even employ a bit of neatly satisfying pop psychology to tell you that confronting winter forced me to confront myself, to sit with my unhappiness rather than run away or distract myself from it. And in doing so, somehow, I transcend it. But none of that really feels true. Maybe it's nothing more or less than the moment itself. That feels honest to me. And that moment wasn't about natural beauty or the mental health benefits of a middle-class existence that allows for weekends in the mountains. It was about simpler things. How the kind of cold that wants you dead focuses the attention, for one. How suddenly realizing you can neither see nor feel your hand in front of your face will remind you, if nothing else does, that, hey, you idiot, you're alive. How being made to feel utterly alone and fragile somehow can bring us back to ourselves. So this morning, I'm going to provide a simple outline of what I found in this story. I'll make a few comments, and then I'm going to leave the rest of the work up to you. Something for you to contemplate during this season of Lent. So this is a 6-point observation outline. Number one, solitude of mind. This is the elimination of the distractions and collateral chattering of a mind, which, as you know, can sometimes be constant. Solitude of mind is taking a little break and creating an opening for something else to arise. Something else that is not as neurotic, driven, or anxious. Even setting aside 5 or 10 minutes a day is a great start, and Lent is a good time to give it a try. Even if it's not easy to do at first, like Ron said, a chance to be alone with my thoughts was the absolute last thing I wanted. It does get easier the more that you do it. Number two, exposure to nature. This was the main content of Ron's experience, I think. Spending time in nature, seeing what that feels like, and then seeing what happens. And as with Ron, the longer your exposure to nature, the more likely there is something that's going to happen. Three, sense of ease. This was when Ron knew something was happening of note. Relaxation or release. In his case, the physical unclenching of his hand and the tension he had been holding on to for who knows how long. And this leads to number four, the open moment, where the moment is stripped down, stripped of everything else but whatever is happening right then. This is a common meditative technique where you become mindful or totally aware of just what you are doing, hiking, skiing, or sitting in a chair by a fire. You don't fill it with anything else except the moment itself, the open moment. And this leads to point five, aliveness, a sense of aliveness. What this all leads to is an amazing, eye-opening, and gratifying sense of simply being alive. Something that you had missed just moments ago, but was now an obvious first-hand reality. Years ago, I was at the cabin one winter, and the temperature was 20 below zero outside. I had a good fire going, and it was over 90 degrees inside. All there was separating me from the outside elements was a 6-inch thick cedar log wall. Over 100 degree difference between the two, inside and outside. That's when the survival gear kicks in. And when you walk outside and you see your warm breath float into the frigid air, you know you're alive. And point number 6, return to self. When you feel so cold, and then you go inside and get close to the wood stove, in touch with those two extremes, and it's a direct experience, you return or come back to your most basic self, that self experience. You know you're alive, and this most basic sense of self dissipates the blues. It eliminates complaint. When you look at what's going on in the world right now, suddenly you consider how fortunate you are, and your response is, what can I do to help? Ron said that being made to feel utterly alone and fragile can somehow bring us back to ourself. Solitude of Mind is a solo journey, one that brings us in touch with our own frailties, loneliness, and humanity. But in so doing, we return to a self that is alive and grounded in our own experience. This is all part of the Lenten journey. So in closing, I'm going to sound the chime and allow the open moment to take you where it will. I want to thank you for being here today. As we extinguish the chalice this morning, I pray with words that are only words, but let the words say this: grace. Not in our power, but perhaps in a larger power, may grace take us from here to the next place we must go, not knowing, but going nonetheless into the unknown, living grace. Amen. I want to thank you all for joining us for today's UU Holton weekly service. Like and subscribe on our YouTube channel. Practice kindness, keep your attitude positive, and keep an eye out for those having a difficult time. I want to thank our cameraman, Christoph, for doing our camera work today, and for Finn down in New Orleans. As the Mardi Gras celebrations are winding down by now, and board barista. And we have a little more music this morning from New Orleans. Here is a short closing clip from my trip to New Orleans back in 2017 for a UU convention. Of course, street musicians are around every corner in New Orleans, and I happen to have my camera to catch a little bit of this. Here is an upbeat song full of complete joy. I hope you enjoy it. Have a good rest of your day, everyone, and we'll see you next time on The Inside Take.
Never see who burns in the sky. Never saw the sun shine so bright. Never saw things going so high. Wish upon the days hurrying by. When you're in love, my how time flies. Those great days, all of them gone. Nothing but the sky.